to introduce Dr. Bradshaw. Dr. Bradshaw first became prompted to do research on the subject of the religious LGBT experience when his son Brett came out about his homosexuality. Since that time, the Bradshaws have been active members in various LDS groups working to support their LGBT children. Dr. Bill Bradshaw and John DeLynn went on to complete the largest study to date on LGBT individuals and religion. Hopefully he's going to present some on that today. So everybody give a hand to Dr. Bradshaw.
It's a genuine honor for me to come. I think I'll choose not to use the mic because I'll be standing in the way of the screen for some people. So if my voice drops and you can't hear in the back, yell at me. There are several reasons why I became interested in the issue of homosexuality. It came up on occasion in my academic life at BYU in courses in molecular biology and cell biology. It came up occasionally in the course of my ecclesiastical callings in the LDS Church. The most important reason for my interest is this. The handsome man on the
right. Pull this back over here.
Sure. The handsome man on the right is my son, Brett. The handsome man on the left is his husband and my son-in-law, Jeff Jackanitz. And the lovely girl in the middle is my granddaughter, who is very successful at working off daddy and papa against one another. She's now a junior in high school in Oakland. Her name is Madeline, and she's even more lovely and energetic than she was when this picture was taken. There are a number of questions, but it seems to me that there are three major questions, and we come to this issue from different points of view and different experiences, but along the line, I think we all have to take some time to think about these. So I put them in the, as if they were nested in the center. In the center one, right in the middle of the target, if you will, is what causes sexual orientation? Why are some of us attracted to people of the opposite sex and others to people of the same sex? It's a complicated question, and there's a huge amount of data, and there is an answer which I will let you in on. Even if we knew all there was to know about the cause, the origin, I think we would then say, well, is this something that people can do something about? Is sexual orientation changeable? And at some point then, with an understanding of what is known about these issues, we would say, well, all right, how do we feel about same-sex relationships? So I'll try to address something about each of these, and I'll do my very best to fight my impulse to tell you all that I know about these things so that you won't get weary and drowsy and fall asleep. Let's try to save a lot of time for your questions. There are two main bodies of thought about the cause of homosexuality, and one is psychological and social, and it's based on views that started with Freud at the beginning of the 20th century. And although oversimplifying, these are some of the major things that people have believed. One, that it's a cause, it's caused by dysfunctional parenting. Dad wouldn't play catch in the backyard with his son, and his son becomes emotionally distant. Mom steps in to try to compensate, and she's overbearing and she's mothering. For these reasons, the young boy becomes gay as an adult. Freud's view about what causes women to be homosexual was much less structured, but had similar sorts of things. People have supposed that being gay or lesbian is caused by sexual experience in youth or adolescence, especially that it's caused by sexual abuse, by molestation. Bottom line, none of those things are true. And there's a lot, and there is significant evidence that those things are not true. I won't attempt to show you any of that evidence. I'm going to say a couple of things before I show that picture again. So, what's the cause of sexual orientation? It's biological. It's caused by, it is due to biochemical mechanisms that operate during embryonic development, especially in the programming of the embryonic brain. So, as you know, men and women are different. The differences that arise in the embryo can be summarized as follows. Being female is the default program. For females with two X chromosomes, the internal sexual organs, the external genitalia, and the, as you know, the most important sexual organ is the brain. All of those things are programmed by the female program, which is the default way that females develop. In males, there's a difference. The difference is a Y chromosome. And the Y chromosome has a gene, and it's called SRY, and we know what it does. It programs changes in DNA. And the result of that is that the gonad of the embryo, which is indifferent in both little boys, embryonic males and females, the gonad is indifferent. You can't tell the difference between a testicle and an ovary in an embryo. They look the same. But in the male, because of the XY chromosome, the gonad becomes a testicle. And it produces testosterone. And testosterone produces all of the changes that differentiate the internal male from the external genitalia in male and females to the brain. And here's the evidence. In spite of what you see, this is a genetic male. This is a man with an XY chromosome. But the testosterone during embryonic development in this person didn't work. This person is a part of a group of individuals called intersex. And the problem in this case has a name. The acronym is AIS, androgen insensitivity syndrome. Androgen is a name for the big family that testosterone belongs to. They make testosterone, but it doesn't work. Why doesn't it work? Steroid hormones are little molecules. They are made out of cholesterol. They get into the bloodstream when they're produced in the embryo. They go to any place they want in the embryonic body, and they go into any cell that they want. But in the target cells where they're supposed to act, they get ushered into the nucleus and they meet DNA and they do things to DNA and to gene regulation. That doesn't happen in this person because the receptor molecule that's supposed to usher testosterone into the nucleus is mutant. It doesn't work. And so these persons have internal testes. Their external genitalia develops as a female. They look absolutely like female. They are raised as females normally. They don't menstruate at adolescence. And when it's investigated, it's found that they have internal testes. So the important question for us is, so what's their sexual orientation? The answer is that it's an orientation as if they were female. They are genetically attracted. They are sexually attracted to men, to males. Testosterone does all of this normally in a male, and that's the difference between all of the sexual features, including the programming of the brain, between men and women. Now, when people have attempted to try to find out how gay men and lesbians are different, they have done research on what is called sexually dimorphic traits, meaning characteristics that are normally different between men and women. And here's a small list of some of them, some of those traits. The bottom line is clear for all of these investigations. Gay men and lesbians are atypical for their sex. Gay men respond like women, straight women. Lesbians respond like straight men. I'll give you just a small amount of the evidence for what I just said. All of you who are married know that the brains of men and women don't work the same. All right, now when you do special tests of cognitive ability, that can be demonstrated. So here's a test where there's a table, and on the table are a lot of little miniature objects, a pair of scissors, a typewriter, a glass, a wrench, a doghouse, and they're covered up with a sheet. And the test subject comes in, sits down, you uncover the sheet, you start the stopwatch, and 30 seconds later, you put the sheet back on, and you ask the person, tell us where all of those objects were in the right place they occupied on the table. Now, you're all silent. That's a terrible way to run a classroom. So you now get 10 seconds, and you guess who's better at this kind of a test, men or women. You all have to guess. Talk. You get 9 more seconds, 8 more seconds. Who does this best? Women do it best in this particular kind of a test. An example of a test that works in the opposite direction is spatial orientation. If you have an array of lines at different angles, and then you bring out another line and you say, which of those lines in the array is at the exact same angle as the test angle, who does best? Males do best at that. So how do gays and lesbians do? We'll just look at the data for one of those tests. So here's the object location memory test. That's the little objects on the table. Who does well in white? Straight women. Who does bad? Straight men. Where are gay men like women? Where are lesbians in the direction of straight men? And that's true for a whole lot of other tests. Bottom line, the brains of gay and lesbians are different than their counterparts among straight men and women.
Question.
Yes?
So do bisexual individuals kind of fall in the median there?
One more time.
Do bisexual individuals fall in the median there, kind of like halfway between a straight woman and a straight man on these tests?
Question is, where do bisexual people fit? Mm-hmm. And there aren't data, unfortunately, on bisexuals to answer your question. I can't give you an answer.
Question.
Yes?
Growing up in the gay community, there's a certain social stigma for a gay man, obviously, to present himself very masculine or very feminine. I'm curious if a man has driven the idea into himself to act exactly like a heterosexual man, if that would test would come out differently.
Do some gay and lesbians pretend to be otherwise? Is that the question, in order to sort of fit in to the social norm?
No, because that's not my question, because the answer to that is yes. My question is, for those who do experience an intense amount of pressure and give into it, would that affect how that test would go for them?
Okay, so the question is, can you fail, can you fool the test?
Yes.
Can you fake the test? Answer no. There are several attributes of hearing that are different. I'll just tell you one of them. It's called the startle response. So when we hear a loud noise, think the 4th of July, think your little dog when he hears the explosions of fireworks. We react. We're startled. We jump, and nearly always we react by blinking our eyes. Now, there's a test. You are given you are allowed to hear a soft noise first, and then a very loud noise. And the question, does the first soft noise dampen your reaction to the second? Pre-pulse inhibition is what this is called. Men and women differ. Men don't react nearly as wildly to the second sound if they've been pre-programmed by a softer sound preliminarily. But women are not inhibited. So where are gay and lesbians? Gay men are not different than straight men in this respect, but lesbians, compare this line with that one, are masculine. This is an important test because it can be proven that it's not learned. That's relative to the question at the back. You can't learn this response. It happens naturally. Lesbians respond different in this aspect of hearing than straight women. There are other aspects of hearing we don't have time, but the bottom line is still the same. In this sexually dimorphic trait, gay men and women respond differently for their sex. Testosterone does other things besides programming how the brain works. It programs the length of our fingers. So, in general, over a very large sample, it's possible to compare the length of the fourth finger and the second finger and make a ratio. I'm going to hold my hand up as representative of men in general. The index finger is shorter than the fourth finger, so the ratio of 2 to 4 is less than 1. In general, women have shorter fourth fingers, so the ratio of 2 to 4 is close to 1, or a little bit longer than 1. You're all looking at your fingers, and that's fine. All right, so the ratio is called 2D, D for digit, 2D to 4D. Males have a number less than 1. Females in general have a ratio greater than 1. So what about gay men and women? Lesbians are masculinized. They have a ratio less than 2. For men, it's complicated. It depends on where you are in the family, in addition to your finger length. We'll address that in just a minute. But finger length is another indication of embryonic exposure to testosterone, and it shows that gay folks are different than straight folks. All right, so the brain works different because of testosterone. Our fingers are different because of testosterone. Try to introduce quickly something else that's really important. In Scandinavia, investigators have conducted PET scans. A PET scan takes a picture of your brain while it's working. It maps the areas of the brain that are firing. They light up, the areas of the brain light up, and you can make a map. When the subject is doing this, this part of the brain is working. When that subject's doing something else, another part of the brain is working. So expose the people to two different kinds of chemical compounds that are like perfume. They can't be detected at a conscious level, but the brain reacts to them. In insects, we call these pheromones. That's why that's why male fireflies and female fireflies are attracted to each other. The ladies put out these odors, the men smell them, and they come running. All right, there are such things in people. And when you expose the brains to a compound generated from testosterone, a certain area of the brain lights up. When you give the person access to another molecule generated from estrogen, a different part of the brain reacts. How do gay men and women react? Gay men light up their brains like women and vice versa. Same story that I've just been telling you. The brains work different. Why do the brains work differently? Because the brains are built differently. There's a very important part of our brain called the hypothalamus. It's responsible for emotion. You can do tests with deceased people and dissect the hypothalamus in the brain and measure a certain region of it. Never mind the name of the region, you'd forget in a few minutes anyway. Can't do this with living people. You have to do it with cadavers. When you do this, you find that this is a sexually dimorphic trait. A certain region of the hypothalamus has more neurons in it. Its volume is different in straight men than straight women. Here's the there's two tests from two different laboratories, three bars. The black ones are for the tallest ones are the volumes of this part of the hypothalamus for straight men. The white bars are the volume for straight women. It's less. This trait is sexually dimorphic. This is the volume for gay men. Like women. Non-masculine like. For this anatomical characteristic of the brain. There's at least three other regions of the brain where there are anatomical differences that have been clearly documented. I'm not going to talk about. There's a very interesting question. There's a very interesting phenomenon as to when people are born in the family. It just applies to gay men. Gay men tend to have older brothers, more older brothers than people in the general population. Not younger brothers, not older or younger sisters. It does not apply to lesbians. So, this is the ratio of siblings. This dotted line horizontally from left to right, that represents the ratio of little boys born to little girls born in the world. It's 1.06, meaning a little bit more male children are born than female children. These are heterosexual persons. This is the ratio of older brothers, this of sisters. For straight people, those numbers are statistically like 1.06. There's no difference in the ratio. But for gay men, there's a big difference. They have many older brothers in general. Now, this has been repeated by 14 different research studies that I know about. There's only one other correlation that's stronger, and that is the correlation between childhood gender nonconformity. We're talking about the little boy who doesn't want a truck or a football for Christmas, he wants a Barbie doll. He wants to dress in his mama's high-heeled shoes and wear her clothes. The corresponding young lady is the best wrestler in the neighborhood and likes rough and tumble games and is better at it than most of the kids in the neighborhood. There's a strong correlation between childhood, gender nonconformity, and sexual orientation in young adulthood. And the next highest correlation is the older brother effect. Now, what's the explanation for the older brother effect? It's a hypothetical explanation. There are no experimental data to support the explanation I'm going to provide. If you think about it, it's because nobody knows how to do the experiment. So the explanation is this. When a mother is carrying a boy baby, she's carrying a foreign object in terms of her immune system. That little baby, that little embryonic boy has a Y chromosome. She doesn't have a Y chromosome, so her body wants to make antibodies against her baby boy. So the belief is that in her blood, there's a certain titer, a certain concentration of antibodies against maleness that builds up with her first boy baby, and a little bit higher for the second boy baby, and a little bit higher for the third or fourth or fifth boy baby, and at some point, those antibodies react against her later born sons and impact the development of the brain. That makes a lot of sense in theory. There's no data to support it. People are trying to figure out ways to test that experimentally. It's a tough test.
I got a question there.
Question.
So does that hypothesis imply that if there's a gay son and the parents have another son, the mother has another son after that gay son, that seems to imply that statistically he would be gay as well?
He has a greater probability of being gay.
Okay.
And 15% of gay men owe their gayness to, apparently, to this older brother. But it turns out to be complicated because one of the other things that testosterone does is to affect handedness. So there's a small proportion of the human population which is left-handed, or ambidextrous. In lesbians, it's very clear. There's an extremely high probability that lesbians are going to be left-handed. But in gay men, it depends on a combination of handedness and when you're born in the family. So most gay men who are the first in their family to be born are left-handed. But gay men who are the second or third or fourth in the family tend to be right-handed. We can't judge this by any one family, but it works in mine. Brett's the third of four sons in our family.
Question.
Yeah, would a sister that is gay, the brother below him, have a more propensity?
There's no impact of sisters, of female
sisters
siblings.
Don't affect the
no
brothers.
Impact of female siblings in this study. Homosexuality runs in families. How many gay people are there in the world? Depends on how you ask the question. If you need a number, say 5%. But it depends on the setting in which you ask the question. It changes if the setting is behavior, or if the setting is attraction, erotic feelings, or if the setting is identity. And a lot of people who are honest and will admit to same-sex erotic feelings won't identify as gay. They will be same-sex attracted, or they will be heterosexual with a problem, but not gay. Gay is one of those guys with not very much clothing on, with wild music on the flatbed truck in the Pride Parade. I'm not one of those. If there's a gay person in the family, the probability of having another gay person in the family increases by at least a factor of three. So a lot of studies have been done with twins. Question?
We got 10 minutes, did I say it?
Oh, okay, thanks. So here are the data. If you look at the concordance, meaning the degree to which one member of the family is gay because another one is gay, among identical twins coming from the same fertilized egg, the concordance is something a little bit higher than 50%. For fraternal twins, less biologically related because they come from two different fertilized eggs, then the concordance drops to somewhere like 20. For non-twin siblings, it's a factor of three greater than what it is for non-related siblings in the family. Bottom line, clearly there's a genetic effect. Homosexuality is due to genetics. The major question is, why isn't the concordance 100% for identical twins. That's a really important question. You don't want to know all that I know about this. I'm just going to tell you one word. Epigenetics. Epi means on top of. Think of the epidermis, the top layer of your skin. Genes are expressed not only because they're there, but because of whether or not the switch that turns them on is working or whether it's turned off. Think light switch. If the switch is on, the gene is expressed. If the switch is off, the gene is still there, but it's dark. It's not being expressed. When we are embryos, every one of the cells of our body is genetically identical. From the very first fertilized egg to a cell in the heart, to the kidney, to the skin, to the brain, they're all genetically the same. All of the 46 chromosomes are there and all the genes are there, but in the brain genes are switched on and the kidney and liver genes are switched off. And the explanation for that is called epigenetics. So it's not, as some opponents of a biological explanation have supposed, it's not because of this environment. It's not because of what happened in the family or whether dad played football or anything else psychologically or even the terrible circumstance of sexual abuse. It's the environment in which the genes are in the embryo. There's a molecule of DNA, that's the gene that's present, but there are other things inside the environment of the embryo, not psychological or social, that can affect whether the switch is on or off. All right, now everybody think one of your cells. You can't see it, can you? It's really, really small. Now go inside and there's something even smaller. It's called the nucleus. It's a lot smaller than the cell you can't see except with a microscope. Inside that are 46 pieces of DNA. Now, imagine that you take them all out, the 46 pieces, and you straighten them out. They're all like rods, 46 pencils. Now line them up end to end, 46 pieces. How long is that genome? How long is the composite of all the chromosomes? 10 seconds. Everybody guess.
6 and a half.
How long? How long are the pieces of DNA in one of your cells you can't see? Guess.
100 feet.
Doesn't matter if you're wrong. It only matters if you don't guess. 6 feet 8 inches. That's Carl Malone. That's how long all pieces of DNA are, and they're in a little tiny nucleus in a cell you can't see. That's a packing job, folks. That's really a packing job. And it looks like this. Best example I can think of is the rubber band airplane you used to play with. Mine was made of balsa wood. You've never heard of balsa wood. You're too young. It's plastic, right? So you have the airplane with the rubber band motor, and you wind up the propeller, and the job is get the propeller as tight, shorten it, reduce the volume, so your plane will go as far as possible. And what happens to the rubber band? It starts to coil. And then it coils on the coils. And then the coils coil on the coils on the coils, and you have something that looks like that. So it's really, really hard to turn the light switch on. To find the one gene down in there that you want to turn on for brain development, you have to unwind it all. And that's called epigenetics. That's what people are working on right now, to try to find the genetic explanation for why Sam and Fred, who may be identical twins, one of them's gay and one of them is not gay, and the reason is that the regulation of the genes is subtle and it depends on how much of the regulation of the light switch is taking place, when it's taking place, and the intensity of that regulatory environment. All right, then switch from biology. I took too much time and I apologize. It's good stuff, though. You have to. You have to know a little bit about some of this. Okay, so 2009, I went to a meeting in the Varsity Theater of BYU. It was for all of the bishops and stake presidents in the BYU wards. It was about homosexuality. It was conducted by Evergreen International, then an organization that promoted reparative therapy. One of the bishops asked a question. How good is Evergreen's promise that you can change gay people's orientation? And Bert Peterson, who was the retired general authority for whom I have admiration, I think he's a wise, good man, and he said, in answer to the question, how many people really change? Hundreds and hundreds. And I didn't think he was lying, but I thought he was wrong. So it seemed to me, that's not a good answer. That's like answers coming out of the White House these days. I'm sorry, you're politically neutral, but I couldn't resist. All right.
We are, you don't have to be.
So I said, this needs to be studied. Where are the data? That was my mantra as a teacher. What are the data? Show me the evidence. Let's look at what the data are and draw a conclusion based on evidence, not based on bias or guesswork. Not the guesswork of hundreds and hundreds. Let's find out. So I was sure that we needed an academic study in which to do the data. I explored a couple of them that didn't work, like San Francisco State. But I had a friend at Utah State. His name is John Levin. John was a student with me in a couple of classes. We had maintained friendship over the years. I said, John, I want to come to Logan and talk to you about it. We had a meeting for lunch. He brought a faculty member. We decided to do the study and to get the reliable data. And so the lady to the right of my picture is Renee Gallagher. She wanted to be involved. We started to design the study. We got the data. John decided to switch his PhD dissertation to use our data, which he has done. We were able to recruit 1,612 gay, current or former members of the church to explain their experience. This is the distribution with respect to membership of the church of our 1,612. It's roughly a third active members of the church, a third inactive, and a third resigned or having had church action taken, I guess. Pretty close to a third of each. Okay, so these are among the things we learned. Here's a timeline for Latter-day Saints. AJ, B stands for baptism, and AP is a running priesthood for boys, and MS is mission, and MA is marriage. And this is the average age at which the 1,612 people in our study told us these events happened in their lives. And we asked about the milestones in their sexual identity. And I'll show you what those 2, 1 through 5 events are from age 9 through 22. And then we asked about the interventions that they had engaged in order to understand or cope with or specifically to change their orientation. We're now on question 2, can sexual orientation be changed? And there are these interventions. Personal righteousness meant do what every good Mormon person is supposed to do, pray and fast and go to the temple and accept every ward calling and never do anything wrong and do what's needed for God to grant you a special blessing. Change the Heavenly Father, because it doesn't fit for me to be gay in my community. So for men, the first sense that they were different than children their age is 9 for a boy. Now, kids at 9 don't know what the difference means. They don't see it in sexual terms. But I'm different somehow than the other kids. I can tell I'm not quite the same as the other kids in the neighborhood. For women, it's a couple of years labor. And the next milestone is, when do you attach a sexual connotation to this difference? For men, about 13. And then when did you first have a same-sex experience? And usually this amounted to having a crush on somebody your same age. This is not a same-sex relationship normally. And then when did you tell somebody else? When did you come out? When did you tell yourself? And you can see that that ranges from 9 to men to 22, a little bit later for women. Importantly, I just looked at these data for those 18 to 30, and for the younger sample in our population, these last numbers go to 18, coming out at 18 on average. So, there are gay straight alliances in schools, and there's Modern Family and Ellen DeGeneres, and reasons why there is a greater degree of public acceptance and a greater willingness to come out. I'm only going to show one of these. Of all the explanations for homosexuality, 80% of both men and women in our study say it's because of biology, not because of their parents. Now, these are data on the interventions. What did people do to try to get help? Individual effort meant usually going online and finding out about what does it mean to be gay? What does queer mean? And then there was personal righteousness, the Mormon paradigm about doing everything right so that you can change. Yes,
Did the respondents universally feel that they were supposed to change their homosexuality?
Did people think universally they were supposed to change? Not universally, but the vast majority felt some kind of pressure or some kind of internal conflict with their religious community. And then church counseling was going to the bishop often in the context of having a missionary interview. And then there were other things. There was professional psychotherapy with a licensed counselor, psychiatry, mostly prescription for antidepressants, for medication, group therapy, and other sorts of things. Journey into manhood retreats, support groups like Evergreen, Exodus International, Jonah, the Jewish equivalent of Evergreen for Mormons. All right, so how successful are these efforts? That's color-coded left to right. So people had a choice of highly effective dark green, a little bit effective light green, not effective yellow, a little bit harmful orange, and really harmful red. So the interventions that were mostly harmful were these three highlighted in blue: the personal efforts and the efforts associated with getting church counseling. My explanation is simple. The reason that these proved most harmful for most people is because the promises were never realized. And it was held out to people that if you're righteous, the Lord will bless you. That's how the gospel works. So you go on your mission and you do everything. You're the best missionary that ever was in your mission, and you come home and you expect to change and you don't change at all. And you say, what's wrong, God? What didn't I do? Maybe you don't like me. Maybe there isn't a God. So a high degree of anxiety and conflict, and unfortunately a loss of religious faith in various degrees for a lot of people. Age along the x-axis and number of people. And the question is, when did you start psychotherapy? And it started as early as age 10. And there's a bell-shaped curve about down to age 30. But look at the tail. Look at the age at which other people in our study started psychotherapy, because this was such a dilemma for them, clear out to age 53. That's 50 years of your life, and this is still a conflict, and you finally can't handle it yourself, so you go to the psychotherapist. And this is the length of time. The average is about 4 years right in here, and here's 10 years. 10 years of trying to deal with this in a psychotherapeutic setting. And here's 20, and here's 30 years. 30 years of life trying to get help, and it still isn't resolved. I read about 800 personal narratives, people describing this experience. John read the same 800. We compared notes and we cataloged the responses. I'll read more. This approach was completely ineffective in changing my same-sex attraction, but eventually completely effective in understanding and fully accepting myself as gay. I prayed earnestly and studied scriptures daily. I fasted weekly for a couple of years. I read each ensign from cover to cover. I served in my wards, calling and home teaching, something to near exhaustion. The effort to change, do all the church and its leaders teach on the subject, was profoundly damaging, depressing, demoralizing, and discouraging. The four bad D's. Because despite their assurances, no real change was coming in diminishing my attraction to men or gaining attraction to women, no matter how hard I tried and believed. Life just kept getting darker and more hopeless, because after doing all they said with so much effort and no change, I felt like a true failure, that I wasn't good enough for God to fulfill their words and promises with me. If God did not love me enough to change me, and since I, as a gay person, do not fit in God's plan, then there's no point in continuing to exist. Suicide truly seemed the only solution. Those years trying to deny and change what I am were very dark and hellish years, despite zealous church service and my best efforts to be righteous. If your eyes are not red inside, you're crying, like me. How can we do this to people we love, no matter how close they are in the family or out of the family or in the ward or in the neighborhood? That is typical, and that is not different than hundreds and hundreds of experiences of these wonderful people. So then, how many of these narratives said that those efforts led to change? The answer is very few. And so this is our catalog of their responses with respect to did they change? This is explicit. I didn't change at all. This is, my goal changed from trying to change myself to accept myself. These are other things. There were some of the essays we couldn't tell. We weren't able to judge, or the issue of change was not addressed. So how many people here in the middle changed? 32 out of 1,612 made some statement about change. And we were not strict on what change could mean.
Question, how accurate do you think they were in saying that they changed? Were they kind of buffed on the answer? Did it sound good or not?
How accurate are the expressions? How honest are people? Well, the answer is you'd have to read them with me, and then you decide whether you think the answers are genuine, or whether they are contrived, or whether they are false. I'm here to witness that they are not contrived at all, and that this was cathartic. People wrote a lot about this. So what were some of the things that we accepted as change? They were the following. I think of the same-sex relationship every day, but I don't act on it. That's not a change in erotic feeling. That's a behavior. That's a statement about controlling my behavior. Same-sex attraction diminished but never went away. One person wrote, "I changed. I was straight for 10 years and then it came back." Well, maybe that person's assessment of real change may not have been accurate. It helped to decrease my negative reaction to my same gender attraction. So it bothered me a lot, and now it doesn't bother me very much. But this isn't a statement about changing your orientation. 32 people out of 1,612, about 4%. There's a question about bisexuality a moment or two ago. So, sexual orientation is best measured on a continuum. And the most frequently utilized scale is called the Kinsey scale. Kinsey was a sexual researcher at Indiana University in the 50s. So the scale is a 7-point scale from 0 to 6. 0, completely heterosexual. 6, exclusively homosexual with these points intermediate along the way. So the blue line at the blue line at the bottom is for men and the red line is for women. And what you will notice is something very important and replicated by a lot of studies around the country. Most homosexual males are nearly or completely homosexual. This scale is for attraction. They are 5s or 6s on the Kinsey scale, but not women. Look at all the women at intermediate scale numbers along the Kinsey continuum. And so they are bisexual to some degree. 3 on this scale is equally having equal attractions for both men and women. So among all of these women from here to here on that scale, it's about 25%. 25% more women in the intermediate parts of the scale than women. Lots of people have demonstrated this. This is what's true for our 1612 LDS sample. Just a couple more. Thanks for your patience. So these data are just for men, and it's about marriage. So age along the x-axis and the y-axis on the left represent the percent of people who are not married. Everybody is not married at age 5, right? So nobody has married, and then when a line starts to go down here at age maybe 18, that indicates that subgroup of people is starting to marry. So there's 4 lines, and there's 2 variables here. This is men only. One of them is Kinsey scale. So we divided people into high Kinsey and low Kinsey. 5s and 6 on the scale of 5. 0 through 4, low. Some degree of bisexuality. That's one of the variables. The other variable is, did you serve an LDS mission? So who gets married? Low Kinseys, bisexual people on a mission. The blue line is for the next group who marry a little bit later and fewer marry. Low on the Kinsey scale, didn't serve a mission. The last 2 are for high on the Kinsey scale with a mission and high on the Kinsey scale without a mission. And the data are that men who are bisexual have the greatest probability of entering into a heterosexual marriage.
people, men, who are high on the Kinsey scale have a low probability of entering into a heterosexual marriage, and how long do the marriages last. So this is about divorce. There are two variables, low and high Kinsey, left to right, and with emission, green, and without emission, blue, and this is divorce. So, with a high Kinsey, nearly exclusively or completely exclusively homosexual in one's erotic feelings, 95% divorce, without emission, with emission, there's a little bit of relief from that, about 85%. Low Kinsey, without emission, it's still 62 or 63%. And bisexual people with emission make it last longer. We use some analyses that measure quality of life. People make a self-judgment about the quality of their lives. And in this part of our data, we measure quality of life as a function of their sexual activity status. The healthy average up here is 90. The red line at 84 represents the quality of life expressed nationally by people who have lived very painful, unfortunate human condition. So in our sample, lowest quality of life, celibate people without a partner, celibate people who choose to be celibate, same-sex relationship that's not committed, same-sex committed relationship, either married or partners for life. It is not good for man to be alone. We learned that even before we got the data. This is quality of life by status in the church. Active, inactive, disfellowship, resign, I know why that's a little humorous. I don't know if, given a little thought, you'll react like I react, but that's pretty sad. I do that, it's terribly unfortunate. That's not the way it's supposed to be. Why is it that way? Well, to me it's clear. Why is it that way? To me, it's clear that it's that way because of the negative messaging that, as an LDS community, people receive.
Dr. Bradshaw?
Question.
And when was this study completed?
We asked for data online from July through October of 2011. So the 1,612 people enlisted during that period of time.
The question. From 80 to 87, how much of a difference is that really? Give me a relative scale.
It's a great question. He had a class at BYU that made him look at the data and determine what their conclusions were. It's statistically significant. I can't tell you the degree to which it's personally different. I'm willing to say it's a trend. And I'm willing to say it's an unfortunate trend.
I would say that's why the Lucas line, the average line is there.
Speak louder so everyone.
I would say that's why the Lucas line and the average line is there.
Yes.
To give you a relative.
Right, but it's still. What's needed is to sit down for 2 hours with every one of these persons and get the details, which we haven't done.
Question. Your first time.
Yes.
Is there any difference in the effect on quality of life from low Kinsey to high Kinsey's? Or was that
Yes. The question is quality of life change as a function of Kinsey score? The answer is yes. I didn't bring the slide to show. Our quality of life increases from 0 to 6 among the people.
Thank you.
People in the middle have some degree of attraction to both men and women, also have conflicts.
I have a question.
Yes.
On that scale, it was for LDS people, as far as the scale goes.
Yes.
So if 80% or 87% of the people are below the 90% of normal happiness, what is that?
That was just the people in the study.
Just in the study of LDS people, just on a national average.
Just in the 1,612 people in our sample.
Just, okay.
Almost done.
I have a question real quick.
Oh, sure.
The excommunicated had a higher happiness level than the resigned. Do you know, did any of them mention as to why, or do you have any inklings as to why those that were excommunicated were happier than those who resigned?
I think because they've completely severed. They've gotten away from the negative message as far as they can. That's why I'm getting desperate. Yes?
Do you have any hypothesis about why people who are more towards the middle of the Kinsey scale rate their well-being lower than those who are kind of on the polar ends?
One more time, please.
So do you have a hypothesis about why people who are like strictly heterosexual or strictly homosexual versus like homoflexible or bisexual, like why are they like, why is it harder to be bi than it is to be like super gay or super straight?
There's a couple of important questions I haven't addressed. Why, I didn't tell you this, did I? Among our respondents, 75% were male and 25% were female. That's not unique to our study. I found 4 other often quoted studies with the same degree of male bias in terms of the people enlisted in the study. I believe, and I'm trying to test it now, that women didn't respond as much as men because there are more women who are bisexual, and these are women who've been able to marry, and they've been able to, and this is true to some degree of men, they've been able to marry and they can stay in the church at least technically. They remain closeted. Nobody in the ward knows that the Joneses are really in a mixed orientation marriage, and Sister Jones is really lesbian in terms of her attractions. But she loves her husband, and especially she, not that strong to say, she loves her husband and she loves her kids. And she finds a way to navigate it, but there's conflict. There's conflict because she's not being genuinely authentic. She's not just she, but especially she. All right. I put an important question in the survey. Have you ever had an experience that you thought originated from deity in which you had felt acceptance as a gay person? Here's an example. I asked if he accepted me as I was gay. The very instant I felt such a sense of overpowering love from on high that I was overcome with emotion and almost collapsed. I felt the spirit and the love and the acceptance of God so strongly that it was tangible, like an embrace of a broken child who finally understood. Upon feeling that heavenly acceptance, the relief that washed over me felt like pure joy. In that moment, I had a divinely inspired epiphany that I could be my gay self and still be loved and accepted by God. I didn't have a reason to hate myself. I didn't have to be someone who I wasn't. I didn't have to hide. I was not alone. One woman wrote, and I'll try to quote it, it would be a paraphrase, but it's often close. I was striving to the West Desert to kill myself. Along the way, I was stopped from speeding. I wasn't paying attention. The highway patrolman who stopped me was so kind to me, he didn't give me a ticket. I felt some concern from him. He left, drove away, I started to cry. I turned my car away, around. I felt the love of God and came home. Well, those are more powerful messages than I can hope to relay to you with confidence. So this is what I know. Sexual orientation is not a choice. It is not caused by any of those social, psychological experiences. It is not a phase that people go through. It is not something that a gay person is going to grow out of. It is not one of the adjectives that you have heard from some people in authority use to try to explain away the fact that some of our dear brothers and sisters and God's children are this way by nature, not by choice. Claims of change are very rare and ambiguous most of the time, and if you want to answer the following question with one word, the question is, are people born gay? The one word answer is yes. Sadly, most Latter-day Saint gay and lesbian people disaffiliate. So you go up in the church, and for 19 years, you hear about families and spouses, and this is the way that we prepare for godliness, and it's through having a loving spouse and loving kids, not always loving, but overall, family is this wonderful place. And this is what we aspire to, and this is what heaven is going to be like, and it's for everybody in your ward except you. You can't have it, you don't belong. You can have fulfillment by being a good home teacher. Excuse me, no. This can have a strong effect on mental health outcomes. Caitlin Ryan and the Family Acceptance Project out of San Francisco State have demonstrated clearly that when families accept their gay children and eliminate rejecting behaviors, welcome the gay friends to the house, stop with the gay jokes, talk, continue to show love, makes a big difference. And there's a bisexuality that it can determine the possibilities for some folks. Thank you for being so patient. I'm very pleased to have been here. Thanks.
questions? Anyone want to ask any more questions?
This has been fascinating. Thank you for the work that you've done. My question is that there's so much more to understand with this and the science and the studies. Are the church leadership, the men that claim to be mouthpieces to God on this earth, are they open to learning about this? Do you know? Do they strive to understand this?
It's a great question, and I'm sorry I can't give you a good answer because I don't know. I know that they are aware of the studies. Unfortunately, some discredited work has been cited by church leadership. So a couple of years ago, there was a lot of attention given to a published paper by Regnerus from the University of Texas, and the question was about whether or not same-sex parenting is successful, or whether or not the children raised by same-sex parents develop deficits of various kinds. He said the answer is yes. And Elder Oaks for a while quoted that study. But the study's not valid, and I can tell you why, but I won't take the time. And discredited, not by me, but by people who audited the paper in the journal that published it. More recently, there's a paper by Mayer and McHugh out of Johns Hopkins. They have they don't believe that homosexuality is a genuine phenomenon. And they quote the right papers, but they disagree with the conclusions of the people who really did the study. That paper is also been quoted. That paper has been disavowed by the other faculty of Johns Hopkins. If there is knowledge at the highest levels of the church about the work, it's not made public. Sorry, not a very good answer, but the best I can do. Gentlemen in red.
Yes, can you speak to gender identity as it relates to transgender online studies? You know, tell us about that.
Questions about gender identity among transgender persons. Unfortunately, there's almost no work on transgender people in the scholarly literature. It's not zero, but it's not enough to have transgender people represented in ethical studies. Or just a handful of transgender people in our sample. So I'll give a personal point of view. When I was set apart, as the president of the Hong Kong mission with responsibility for South Vietnam, Mayor Ngirongi laid his hands on my head and said, "I bless you with the spirit of discernment, and you'll be able to tell when your missionaries are telling you the truth, and you're going to need it." I almost looked up to see if he was laughing. So
That's the way I answer the question. Attempting to be worthy of spirit and discernment to find out when somebody's telling me the truth. And when a transgendered person, born female, but needing to find happiness as a male in a male identity, and I listen to that story and I try to exercise that same spirit, then I believe it and I say that's true when you're telling me what's occurred. Yes, sir.
Would you have recommendations for those of us who have various connections in the LDS Church that could be taken to make it more of an acceptable atmosphere for those in LGBT situations?
Circle.
How can we eliminate homophobia in the church? How can we do better? Speak up.
There's also
come to my high priest court and when you hear things that are below me, say no, it isn't right.
There's also Provo chapter PFLAG. Randy, where's Randy at? Randy's the president of that chapter, and they meet once a month on Tuesdays at the St. Mary's Episcopal Church, and that's a really great resource. And a lot of parents that show up there going, okay, I just learned my child is gay, how do I accept this? And there are a lot of parents they can talk to model positive ways of thinking about it.
I like that Dr. Bradshaw mentioned the Family Acceptance Project. Even if it's Family Acceptance Project in your bishop's hand, I will give it to you today if you had it in my car. So
those pamphlets are great.
So those are all great ways to learn. The important thing is don't stay silent. Start speaking and start talking and express yourself to anybody who's willing to listen.
I'll look up. Thank you.
Yeah, we should probably maybe one more question.
That's better.
What is your, over the years, I'm sure it's changed, but I mean, you're emeritus now with BYU, but what was, when you became more outspoken on some of these subjects, what was your, how did the university and how did a separate...
Did I ever get called on the carpet?
well I'm curious. I'm sure the faculty treated you different than maybe your fellow professors. I'm curious... Was there a difference there, biology professors versus the general perception by some of the faculty?
So the question is about the response that I had having become an activist about this,
yeah,
especially at BYU.
From administration versus faculty.
So I gave my first talk on this on a Thursday, I think in March. So it was at 4:00, and I decided to give the talk, and then I spent quite a bit of time trying to learn what was true. So I made a lot of overheads, and I called up the scheduling office, and I got a room in the bar, seated 220 people, and I went around and put up flyers on the walls, and I showed up and I gave the talk, and somebody from the Daily University student called that morning and said, can we come and listen? And I said, of course. They came with a photographer and they took a picture, and the next morning at the Daily University, on the bottom of the front page was a picture of me with my overheads. And I said, BYU professor says that homosexuality is a biological origin. And I got a call from a friend in the administration that was telling you that was the truth. So I got a call from the administration from a man who ran the office of research with whom I had dealt. And he said, what prompted you to give the talk? He was kind and not angry or anything. So I went over and talked to him and I gave him a copy of the overheads. And I said to him,
Did you draw the short straw this morning on the fourth floor of the administration building? He didn't say anything. So I figured I was kind of close with that. That's all it was ever said. And nobody got after me. One of my colleagues said thanks, and I got 75 emails over the next six days from people saying thank you, thank you. And a couple who didn't believe, but most people were pleased. I did it again a couple of times. I have not had any formal negative response.
What year was that?
I think. Thanks.